What keeps roller coasters from coming off the track? How does the seat restraint keep you safe throughout the ride? In this video, we'll explore roller coaster innovations over the years, from ice-covered wooden slides all the way to modern coasters that use magnets to start the ride. Thanks to Brilliant for sponsoring this video. The modern roller coaster uses clever physics to give us the thrill of a lifetime. Of course, while keeping the riders perfectly safe. But roller coasters didn't always work like this. The idea for the roller coaster started with ice-covered wooden slides. They called them Russian mountains. The riders would go down on wooden sleds or blocks of ice. Then in France, they rolled with the idea. They used wooden rollers for sleds to coast down. This is possibly where we got the term roller coaster. The next step was to add wheels to the sleds. One of the more famous rides was called the aerial walk. Passengers would ride in a three-wheeled cart down one of the sides. Meanwhile, in the United States, a coal-hauling railroad discovered that they could send people down the side of the mountain. Passengers really enjoyed this. A businessman named Lamarcus Adna Thompson saw this and realized there was an opportunity. He built the Switchback Railway. It was the first purpose-built roller coaster in the United States. Passengers would ride on simple benches with wheels over several gentle hills. The top speed was about 10 kilometers per hour, a nice gentle ride in the park. At the end, the cars were manually pushed up the side for the next riders. The Switchback Railway was only the beginning. Over the next 130 years, there would be many innovations to make the roller coasters safer, faster, and more daring. To show how these work, let's design our own roller coaster. We'll start by making our roller coaster as simple as possible. Basic supports with a wooden track and a simple car with four wheels. The first improvement we'll make is to add a steel railing to protect the wood underneath. The car uses gravity and momentum to gently go down the track. We don't want to go too intense yet. The riders have a lot of work to climb to the top of the tower to board the cars. Just like the Switchback Railway we saw earlier, we'll build another track going the opposite way. This is an open circuit track. This is how many early roller coasters were built in the late 1800s. But we don't really have an easy way to get the cars back up to the top. So let's make a few changes. First, we'll make it one continuous loop. This is called a closed circuit track. And we'll make our loading platform right here at the bottom. That way riders don't have to climb as many stairs. Now, what about this hill? If we can just get the cars up to the very top, gravity takes over and does the rest of the work. It's a free ride from here. This initial part of the track is called a lift hill. The most common way to send cars up a lift hill is by a roller chain. This is usually placed in the center of the track and rests on a slide plate. There is a motor at the bottom that rotates the chain. The chain goes all the way up and just over the very top of the hill. On the bottom of our roller coaster car, let's place something called a chain dog. It's a simple metal lever. When a car gets to this point on the track, the chain dog at the base of the vehicle grabs onto a gap in the chain, which pulls it up the hill. The chain pulls it just beyond the top, where the chain dog will disengage and gravity takes over. But what if something happens to the chain? What if it breaks? We don't want the car to come barreling back down the lift hill into the loading station. That could be a disaster. To prevent that, we'll need to add the anti-rollback dogs. Then on the track, we'll add a series of metal teeth called a ratchet rail. Now watch as the car goes up the lift hill. If the chain were to fail for any reason, the backward motion of the cars would lock into the ratchet rail, preventing the car from rolling back. Maybe you've heard that clicking sound when you go up the lift hill on a roller coaster? That is the anti-rollback dogs, keeping you safe. Once we're at the top, it's all downhill from here. But how do we stop? That could be another disaster. In the early days, braking was often done by hand, with a brakeman on the car itself. He would pull a lever to stop the car. Another way is to use something called a skid brake. It uses large friction pads on the track. Usually, these sections are located near the end of the ride, with an operator controlling it with a lever. Most early roller coasters were designed to be gentle and scenic. But what if we want something a little more intense? We can add a steeper drop hill. We could even add a loop to our roller coaster. But it turns out that the wrong shape can cause whiplash and other injuries. Early roller coasters actually tried this, but it didn't go so well. It turns out that wooden roller coasters are not ideal for this. We'll come back to loops later in the video. Right now, gravity and centripetal force around a curve are the only things keeping the car from coming off the track, which means we need to be very careful when making things faster. One of the things we love about modern roller coasters happens right about here. It's called airtime. It's where you feel like you're actually floating off of your seat. It happens on big drops, and it also happens when going over hills with enough speed. The danger is having the car go too fast and actually lifting off the track. Not good. So it's time for some improvements to our roller coaster car. The wheels we have so far are called running wheels, or road wheels. Let's improve stability by adding two more types of wheels. These are called upstop wheels, or under-friction wheels. These will keep the car from coming off the track. It was patented in 1919 by John Miller, and it's one of the most important roller coaster innovations. Then we'll add guide wheels, also called side wheels. This helps the coaster steer around the track from side to side. Installing these wheels means that our roller coasters can get a lot more interesting. Higher drops, faster speeds, and sharper turns became possible. This is where the fun begins. Now that we can ensure that the cars won't come off the track, we also need to keep passengers from being thrown out of the car. On our roller coaster car, let's add the locking safety bar. On early roller coasters like this one, it would often use a ratchet system. When riders pull it down, they will hear a clicking noise as they pull it into place. That sound is the result of a pin interacting with gear teeth to keep the restraint locked in a specific position. The pin prevents the bar from going back up. For added safety, we'll add a second pin. The bar will still lock even if one of the pins fails. When the ride ends and the car returns to the station, there's often a mechanism on the track that triggers the release of the pins. This can also be done manually by the ride operator. Now let's add more seats for riders and more than one car on a roller coaster. Now many people can ride at once. Our roller coaster tracks become increasingly complex, and this means that the connection between the cars needs to become more flexible. We'll use something called a universal joint. This allows movement in any direction that they need to go. We'll put two universal joints on each car. This connection between the cars is called a hitch. Let's upgrade the cars to be a bit more modern looking. Yeah, that looks about right. But we can only do so much with a roller coaster made out of wood. Instead, let's change this to be a steel roller coaster. Not just the track, but the supports as well. This allows for even more complex designs. But the steel tracks have the same shape as the wooden track layouts from before. To improve things even more, we'll use a tubular steel track. This is what people usually think of when we talk about steel coasters today. The first to use this was on a ride called Matterhorn Bobsleds at Disneyland in California. Using a tubular track is smoother and can be bent in a lot of different ways. Combine this with stronger support columns and you can start making even more ambitious designs. As our roller coaster becomes faster and more ambitious, we'll need a more reliable braking system. Let's replace our skid brakes that we had earlier with something else. This is a fin brake, sometimes called a clamp brake. Then we'll attach a steel fin to the bottom of the car. Brake pads on the track will clamp onto the fin, slowing the train with friction. Fin brakes are placed on straight sections of the track called brake runs. They are computer controlled today and remain closed by default as a safety measure. With all of these new innovations, I think it's about time we try loops again. Last time we tried to do a perfect circle, but this is quite the jolt for our riders. Thanks to the steel track's strength and flexibility, loops can now be shaped like a teardrop, reducing extreme forces and ensuring a smoother ride. The shape makes the change in direction much more gradual. No more whiplash like before. Steel structures and tubular track designs opened the door for new elements, such as corkscrews, zero-G rolls, and more complex inversions. But if we're going to start inverting and spinning, we'll need more secure restraints. A simple lap bar can only do so much. Let's add an over-the-shoulder restraint. While you could use a ratchet system for this, like we saw earlier, many over-the-shoulder restraints today are controlled by a hydraulic system, which is a bit more advanced. Hydraulic systems work by using fluid pressure. When the restraint is pulled down, fluid is pulled into the cylinder. A one-way valve ensures that the fluid can't flow the other direction, which means the restraint can't go back up until the end of the ride or it's released by the operator. When it's time, a valve will reverse the fluid out of the cylinder, which allows the restraint to go back up. The ratchet system from earlier has only fixed positions, depending on the gear teeth. The advantage with the hydraulic system is that the restraint can be adjusted to each rider's needs, locking in at any point. For safety, each seat restraint usually has a secondary piston included as a backup. Remember our fin brake from earlier? These rely on friction, which means the pads wear out over time. Let's upgrade to something more modern called magnetic brakes. Two permanent magnets on the bottom of the cars. Then on the track, we'll place a series of metal fins that are not magnetic, usually made of copper or aluminum. When the cars get to this point on the track, the magnets slide around the metal fins on the track. This slows the roller coaster down. Now, why is that? Imagine two magnets, put the same poles together, and the magnets repel each other. Remember this concept here. When the magnets on the train slide around the fin, something interesting happens. It causes electrons to start moving around inside the fin, tiny swirls of electricity. They call these eddy currents. These eddy currents create their own magnetic fields. Remember what happens when two magnets come together with the same poles? The same thing happens with the train. It's almost like opposing magnets are appearing right in front, slowing the train down without actually touching it. Notice how there's no outside electricity connected to the fins. This works just by using the movement of the roller coaster. As the train slows down, the eddy currents get weaker, which means the magnetic brakes can't stop it all the way. We still need to use those fin brakes from earlier to come to a complete stop. Magnetic systems can do more than just brake a roller coaster. They can actually accelerate it when used properly. This means you don't always need that traditional chainlift hill. They call this a launch hill. We'll accelerate the cars on the flat part with enough speed to make it up the hill. Let's see how this works. On the bottom of the cars, we'll keep the permanent magnets we had before. We like those. Then on the track, we'll place similar fins in a longer row. The big difference is that these have stator coils inside them. When we power it with electricity, we'll have complete control over the magnetic field. Let's simplify this a little bit so we can get the basic idea of what's happening here. By using electricity, we can create magnetic fields on the track. Using computers to control the timing will cause the train cars to move. Remember, the same sides repel and opposite sides attract. Move the magnetic fields and the car accelerates. This is called a linear synchronous motor, and it's commonly used in roller coasters today. Our final roller coaster rides on top of the track, but there are some roller coasters that actually go beneath the track. This is called an inverted roller coaster. The wheel system works the same way, but the rider's feet dangles beneath the track. This gives a different experience for the rider. In recent years, steel roller coasters have been going higher and higher. They like to rank these roller coasters by height. Let's look at an example from each of these. A hypercoaster drops more than 61 meters. A good example is the Magnum XL 200, which opened in 1989. An example of a gigacoaster is Millennium Force, which opened in 2000. There are only two stratacoasters that have ever been built. This is the world-famous King de Ka. Ride was permanently closed at the end of 2024 and demolished shortly after. Sad day. The first exocoaster is set to open in 2025, called Falcon's Flight. It will be just a little taller than the Gateway Arch. Roller coasters rely a lot on physics, whether it's keeping riders safe inside of a loop or understanding those mysterious magnetic brakes. Make sure you explore concepts like these in a way that actually clicks. This is why I enjoy Brilliant.org. Brilliant helps you learn every day with interactive lessons in math, science, programming, data analysis, and AI. These lessons help you learn by actually doing it. This hands-on method is proven to be 6 times more effective than just watching a video about it. Build your understanding from the ground up. Brilliant is constantly bringing you new and updated content, like the math courses that help you visually learn or just refresh on the basics all the way up through calculus and beyond. Brilliant has something for everybody, whether you're a student still learning or a professional wanting to keep your skills sharp. Head to brilliant.org/JaredOwen to try it for free for a full 30 days. You can also get 20% off your annual premium subscription. My name's Jared. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.